So there was a scientist named Kurosawa in Japan. He was investigating the mechanism by which this fungal pathogen named Gibberella fujikuroi led to the foolish seedling or buccane disease in rice plants. He was working on rice plants, and at that time he found that the rice plants became excessive tall. Okay, this tallness is because these rice plants were affected by a pathogen. That was a fungal pathogen, and the name of the fungus was Gibberella fujikuroi. So when rice plants were infected by this fungal pathogen, it made the plants grow excessive tall, and in that condition there were no formation of seedlings. Okay, so they named this disease foolish seedling or the buccane disease, okay, which made the rice plants grow excessive tall but did not produce any seed. And this pathogen is a fungal pathogen. Okay, the name of that fungus is Gibberella fujikuroi, which made the plants excessive tall. Okay, now another scientist named Yabuta and Sumuki, what they did, they found that these fungus secrete a chemical substance which caused the tallness. So they isolated this chemical substance from the filtrate of the cultured fungus. So from the filtrate of cultured Gibberella fujikuroi fungus, they isolated one chemical and they named that chemical gibberellin. Okay, so the gibberellin name came from the fungus Gibberella fujikuroi. Okay, so unlike auxins, which are classified on the basis of function, so like different auxins we studied IPA pathway, so there are other auxins like that, like indole butyric acid, okay, naphthalene acetic acid. So there are different auxins, and different auxins have different functions. Okay, but the structure is more or less similar. So auxins are classified on the basis of function, okay, but gibberellin are classified on the basis of both structure as well as function. Now how, that we will see in some time, but they are classified on the basis of both structure and function. So from here also the question came. Okay, now these gibberellins are named from GA1. So gibberellin are also said to be as gibberellic acid. Okay, gibberellin or gibberellic acid, so in short now we will write GA. Okay, so gibberellins are named from GA1 to GAN on the order of their discovery. So which one was discovered earlier, they were named like 1, then the one which was discovered after 1, it was named GA2, and so on. Okay, now these gibberellins, they have either C19 or C20 carbon atoms. Okay, now C19 gibberellic acids are more active than C20. Okay, now there are certain structural requirement for gibberellin activity. What is that structural requirement for gibberellin activity? There should be a carboxyl group at the carbon 7. Okay, so all biologically active gibberellins should have the carboxyl group at carbon 7. Okay, so the presence of carbon 7 and the carboxyl group at carbon 7 is the feature of the active gibberellin. okay, and remember the C19 gibberellins are more active than C20. Okay, C20 means C20 carbons. Now coming to gibberellin biosynthesis. So gibberellins are synthesized in the apical tissues, in the young leaves, and they are found in highest amount in immature seeds. Okay, since they helps in germination, which we will see after some time that the main role of gibberellin is that they help in germination. So when they are present in highest amount in immature seeds, okay, so gibberellin have the role in the immature seeds in the mobilization of sugars. I'll show you in the later slides that they are found in the highest amount in the immature seeds and developing fruits, and mainly in apical tissues. Now these gibberellins are derived from ant corine ring structure. I'll show you the step by step biosynthetic pathway, then it will be more clear to you. So look here, we discussed that the precursor of auxin was IAA. The precursor of gibberellin was tryptophan. Then we discussed cytokinin, whose precursor was IPP. Okay, so the precursor of gibberellin is also IPP. I again tell the full form. So full form is written here. Isopentanyl pyrophosphate IPP is the precursor of gibberellin. Now, first we will start the pathway from here. Now this is a precursor of gibberellin, IPP. This IPP will isomerize to form dimethyl allyl pyrophosphate, which we saw in cytokinin also. DMAPP, diphosphate or pyrophosphate. Okay, so this will be isomerized into dimethyl allyl pyrophosphate. Now, one molecule of IPP and one molecule of DMAPP. So 5 carbon, and this is also 5 carbon. So there will be a condensation reaction. See, DMAPP will react with one molecule of IPP. This will be a condensation reaction. So IPP is also a 5 carbon. 5 and 5 will react to form a 10 carbon molecule. Okay, now the name of that 10 carbon molecule is geranyl pyrophosphate. Okay, geranyl pyrophosphate. Now this is a 10 carbon molecule. Now this 10 carbon geranyl pyrophosphate will again combine with IPP, which is 5 carbon. So 10 plus 5 is 15 carbon compound. The name of this 15 carbon compound is farnesyl pyrophosphate, which is a type of sesquiterpene. Okay, now one 15 carbon compound and again one 5 carbon compound will condense. So 15 plus 5 is 20. So the name of the 20 carbon compound is 2 times geranyl. Geranyl pyrophosphate. First was G for one geranyl. Second has 2 G. So geranyl pyrophosphate. Now this geranyl is a 20 carbon compound. After this step, copalyl is formed. From copalyl, ent-corine is formed. Ent-corine forms GA12 aldehyde, and from GA aldehyde, what are formed? GA12 is formed, and from GA12, GA53 is formed. Okay, and 12 and 53, GA12 and GA53 are responsible for the formation of all other gibberellins. So if I summarize again what happened starting from IPP, so this pathway is showing how IPP is synthesized. We will not study about this right now. So IPP is a 5-carbon compound. It isomerizes to form DMAPP. So one molecule of IPP and one molecule of, just a moment, so look here, one molecule of IPP and one molecule of DMAPP, they react to form a 10-carbon compound, which is geranyl pyrophosphate. Now geranyl pyrophosphate, which is a 10-carbon compound, it will react with one molecule of IPP to form 15-carbon compound, which is farnesyl pyrophosphate. Now farnesyl is a type of sesquiterpene. Now this farnesyl will again react with one molecule of IPP, which is again a 5-carbon. It will form geranyl pyrophosphate, which is GGPP, which is a 20-carbon compound. And a 20-carbon compound is named to be as diterpene. 10-carbon compound is named to be as monoterpene. Okay, so about monoterpene and diterpene we will study in detail in the secondary metabolite class. Okay, now you remember that gibberellins are the diterpenes, okay, because after which we see that they remained in the 20-carbon form. Okay, so they are the diterpenes. So geranyl will form copalyl will form entocorine will form aldehyde. From aldehyde, two types of gibberellin are formed, GA12 and GA53. Now GA12 and GA53 are responsible for the formation of all other gibberellins. Okay, I hope this is clear. So here it's written that all other GAs, it can be 20-carbon or it can be 19-carbon. Okay, and 19-carbon GAs are more active. Now look at this picture, how this IPP is formed, which we missed or which we overlooked, like these three steps, how this are formed. So look here. So here what we see, from geranyl pyrophosphate, we have studied GGPP. So starting before the formation of IPP, what happens? Acetyl COA will form mevalonic acid. Mevalonic acid will form mevalonic acid pyrophosphate, which will form IPP. Okay, so IPP is formed from the mevalonic acid pathway. Please remember that. So IPP is formed from the mevalonic acid pathway. What was the main precursor of that pathway? What was the main precursor of mevalonic acid pathway? It is acetyl COA. Okay, so from here up to here it's clear. Now we know that cytokinin's precursor was also IPP. Their pathway we already studied. If we're just giving you the summary once more, that first adenosine, first from IPP, AMP was formed. AMP will form adenosine. Then it has formed isopentanyl adenine. So one step which is jumped, it will be isopentanyl adenine. If you have not watched the video of cytokinin, please watch it. Isopentanyl adenine, which is a precursor of all other cytokinin. Now another hormone, ABA, it also has a precursor IPP. Okay, please, if you remember, if you do not remember, please watch the plant hormones video from the very beginning. The pathways which has IPP as the precursor are known as isoprenoid pathway. Okay, the pathways which have IPP as the precursor is known as isoprenoid pathway. And hormone gibberellin, hormone cytokinin and hormone ABA, all are synthesized by isoprenoid pathway because they have IPP as a precursor. IPP is what? Isopentanyl diphosphate or isopentanyl pyrophosphate. Okay, so if I see about ABA, we already discussed this also. So see, IPP will form carotenoids to violaxanthin, then it was zeaxanthin and neoxanthin. Okay, after that it was aldehyde and abscisic acid. Okay, so what we discussed till now, if I summarize, biosynthesis of gibberellin. So what we studied, so what was the first step? IPP, which is a 5 carbon compound, it was isomerized to form DMAPP, which is dimethyl allyl pyrophosphate. So isomerization of IPP formed DMAPP. So I'm not writing that step, the isomerization step. So IPP is reacting with DMAPP to form what? 10 carbon compound, which is geranyl pyrophosphate. Okay, in short we can write it GPP. In the second step, what happened? This GPP, which was what? A 10 carbon compound. Now the 10 carbon compound was named as monoterpene. Okay, now GPP will react with another molecule of IPP. So this was 10 carbon, this was 5 carbon. So 10 plus 5 is 15. The name was farnesyl, F-A-R-N-E-S-Y-L, farnesyl pyrophosphate. Okay, so the basic unit was what? The basic unit was IPP. Okay, which formed in farnesyl, which is a 15 carbon compound. And this farnesyl pyrophosphate is a kind of sesquiterpene. So monoterpene, then sesquiterpene. Then coming to the third step. So if I write this in short, FPP or farnesyl diphosphate. So FPP will react with another molecule of IPP. So this is 15 carbon. This is 5 carbon, will form a 20 carbon molecule. Now the 20 carbon molecule is named as geranyl pyrophosphate. Okay, which is GGPP. This is a 20 carbon compound. And this is a diterpene. Okay, now this GGPP is the precursor of many terpenoid compounds. Okay, this GGPP is the precursor of many terpenoid compounds, including carotenoids. Just a moment. Including carotenoids and many kind of essential oils. Okay, and after this pathway only, after the formation of GGPP only, the pathway becomes specific for gibberellin. So after the formation of GGPP, the pathway becomes specific for gibberellin. Okay. So in the next step, we will study a portion of gibberellin biosynthetic pathway. We studied that after aldehyde, there is a formation of GA12 or GA53. But what happens after that, which we will study now. So up to geranyl pyrophosphate we saw in the last slide. See, just check. See, up to geranyl we did in the last slide. After that, what happens is that the formation of copalyl will form end-chorine ring. End-chorine will form aldehyde. Then GA12, which is the precursor of all other gibberellic acid. From GA12, GA53 is formed, which also forms some kind of gibberellic acid. Now there is an enzyme named GA20 oxidase. Okay, this GA20 oxidase will go on oxidizing all other gibberellins, and finally it will produce GA19 and GA20. Okay, so we do not have to remember these steps. After GA53 till GA19, we do not have to remember the intermediate steps. What we have to remember is that after GA12, GA53 is formed. So GGPP will form what? Copalyl. Copalyl will form, I'm not writing diphosphate, okay, I'll write copalyl diphosphate, which will form GA12 aldehyde. Now this forms GA12, and this GA12 again forms GA53. Okay, GA12 also produces some kind of gibberellic acid, and GA53, I am writing G but it will be GA, this will also be GA, GA53. They also produce some kind of gibberellic acid. So both produce all other kind of gibberellic acid or GA. Okay, so here what happens, GA12 when forms GA53, GA53 on oxidation forms what? It forms GA19. Okay, this GA19 will form GA20. Okay, so here the enzyme that will be required will be GA20 oxidase. Okay, so till it is not formed GA19, okay, GA20 oxidase is the enzyme in all other intermediate steps from GA53 till GA19 and GA20, the intermediate enzyme is, the enzyme required to form the intermediate step is GA20 in all the steps from GA53 to GA19 and GA20. All the intermediate steps require the enzyme GA20 oxidase. Okay, once GA20 oxidase is once GA20 is formed, okay, it will produce GA1 and GA29. So it will produce GA1 and GA29. So see, there is the enzyme difference over here. Now GA20, when GA3 oxidase acts on GA20, it will form GA1. But when GA2 oxidase will react on GA20, it will form GA29. Okay, now remember one thing, whenever 3 oxidase will catalyze the reaction, it will produce the active gibberellin. Okay, when 2 oxidase will catalyze, it will produce inactive auxin. So what here, from here what we understand that the GA29, that active gibberellin, are GA1, okay, and inactive one are GA29. So whenever 2 oxidase is acting, it will produce inactive auxin. Whenever 3 oxidase is acting, it will produce active auxin. Here you see, after GA1, the enzyme again which is acting is GA2 oxidase. So when GA2 oxidase will act, the gibberellin which will be formed will be inactive. Okay, as the enzyme 2 oxidase is acting, the gibberellin that will be produced will be an inactive gibberellin. So GA29 and GA8 both are inactive gibberellin. Okay, now here what we see, that this picture, this schematic presentation, what it shows, it shows the abbreviation CLE, SLN, SLN, NA, LS. Okay, this chart shows the abbreviation and location of the mutant genes which will block the pathway in P. So these mutant genes, okay, so the highlighted ones are mutant genes. Okay, what these mutant genes will do, they will block the pathway in P. These mutant genes will block the pathway in P. Okay, and they will also block the enzymes involved in the metabolic steps after GA53. Okay, so what we see, that so this one is more important. So in the normal pea plants, okay, in the normal pea plants, they have a gene named as, so if I write here with another color, so in the normal pea plants or the wild type pea plants, what we see, that there is a normal gene named as LE gene. Okay, when this LE gene is present, then the plant is of normal height. But when this LE gene are mutated, that means small LE gene, when they are mutated in pea plants, the plants become dwarf. Okay, so here, when in this case, when LE mutant gene is there, what happened, they cannot synthesize GA3 oxidase enzyme effectively. Okay, so mutant genes, LE mutant genes, cannot synthesize the enzyme GA3 oxidase properly. In that case, the active gibberellin cannot be produced. So when active gibberellin cannot be produced, the plant remains dwarf. Okay, rest all other mutant enzymes are not important from your exam point of view, so I'm not discussing that. Rest all mutant genes are not so important. So see, whatever we studied in the whole biosynthesis, it is completed in 3 steps. It is completed in 3 stages in 3 different organelles. Okay, what we are studying here, that 3 different organelles are involved in the biosynthesis of gibberellin. So first is plastid, second is endoplasmic reticulum, and third is cytoplasm. Okay, so GGPP, how it is formed, we discussed. This GGPP will, the pathway will start in plastid. Okay, it will start in plastid where the diterpenoid will be formed. Okay, and here what will happen, the diterpenoid will form entcorine. कोरिनोल और एंट कोरिन. सो वॉट वी हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट डाइटर्पेनॉइड विल फॉर्म कोपालेल दैट वी नो विच विल फॉर्म एंट कोरिन. नो एंट कोरिन विल बी फॉर्म्ड इन प्लास्टिड. प्लीज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, प्लीज फोकस ऑन दिस बिकॉज क्वेश्चन कम्स फ्रॉम दीज इंटरमीडिएट्स ऑफ जिबरेलिन बायोसिंथेसिस. ओके, सो एंट कोरिन इज फॉर्म्ड वेयर इट इज फॉर्म्ड इन प्लास्टिड. नाउ आफ्टर दैट वॉट विल हैपन. Now, I already discussed that the formation of GGPP is representing the first step, and that is the formation of GGPP. This shows that the pathway is now specified for gibberellin biosynthesis. Once GGPP is formed, it can be said that the pathway is now specified for gibberellin biosynthesis. Otherwise, from IPP, cytokinin can also be formed. ABA can also be formed, but once from IPP, GGPP is formed, we can understand that now the pathway is specified for gibberellin. It is going to synthesize gibberellin because it has formed GGPP. Okay, now in the first step, there are several inhibitors. Okay, so what are the inhibitors? The inhibitors are, I'll show you. So the inhibitors are AMO16. Wait. So here. Here. AMO15, AMO1618, cyclosel. Phosphon D, okay, so these are the inhibitors of the first step of gibberellin biosynthesis. Okay, what is the first step of gibberellin biosynthesis? The first step is the formation of ent corine ring. Okay, second, now the next stage occurs in where? The next stage occurs in the endoplasmic reticulum. So here what happens? The corine will be transferred in the form of corinol will be transferred, and here it will be formed corinol. Okay, corinol will form corinol. It will form what ultimately? GA12 aldehyde, then GA12 and GA53. Now we know that 12 and 53 are the precursor of all other gibberellins. Okay, so remember, in the endoplasmic reticulum, GA12 and GA53 are produced, and in the plastid, corine was produced. Okay, now coming to the cytosol. Now GA53 will form what? GA19 and GA20 in the cytosol. Now this 19 and 20 will form active GA, which we saw in the last slide, and this GA12 will form what? GA15, GA24 and GA9. Okay, so remember this GA9, GA24, they all are active gibberellins. Okay, so GA9, GA24, they all are active gibberellins. Okay, so ultimately the active bioactive gibberellin is formed where? It is formed in cytoplasm. So corine was formed in plastid. GA12 and 53, which is the precursor of all other gibberellin, is formed in endoplasmic reticulum, and GA1, which is a bioactive gibberellin, it is produced in cytoplasm. Okay, now here also several inhibitors act. Okay, so look here. So again, if I say in summary that gibberellins are what? They are tetracyclic diterpenoids because they are formed from GGPP. They are formed from the condensation of four isoprenoid subunits. That means four IPP will form together. That means 4 into 5 carbon compound, which forms 20 carbon compound. This 20 carbon compound has this end gibberellin ring structure. Okay, this 20 carbon compound have end gibberellin ring structure, and this end gibberellin ring structure is known as corine ring. Okay, now so we discussed that the basic subunit is isopentanyl pyrophosphate, and the whole pathway is divided and completed in three cellular compartment. So first was plastid, second was ER, and the third is cytoplasm. So if we do the summary of the biosynthesis of gibberellin, what we found? That GGPP will form copalyl and copalyl to end corine in plastids. Okay, in endoplasmic reticulum 12 and 53 were formed. Okay, now depending on whether the GA is hydroxylated at carbon 13. Okay, this I'll describe. So see, in the third stage, in the cytosol, what happens? GA12 or GA53 are converted to other GA. I told GA1 is formed and GA9 and all other GAs are formed. Now this conversion proceeds in series of oxidation at carbon 20. I told from GA53 to GA20 there are several oxidations, like GA20 oxidase was the enzyme. There were several oxidation steps to form C19 and C20 GA. Okay, now in the 13 hydroxylation pathway, which is in the second step written, now in the 13 hydroxylation pathway, this leads to the production of GA20. Now GA20 is then oxidized to the active gibberellin. Okay, now GA20 will be oxidized to GA1 active gibberellin, and the enzyme here was GA3 oxidase I discussed. Now this GA3 oxidase, what it does? It forms the 3 beta hydroxylation reaction. Okay, now the hydroxylation at carbon 2 converts GA20 to GA1 to the inactive form GA29 and GA8. So when the hydroxylation is at 3 beta region, then bioactive gibberellin are produced. But when the hydroxylation is at 2 carbon 2, then inactive gibberellin are produced. So what are inactive gibberellins? They are GA29. Okay, so GA20 will produce GA29, and GA1 when GA2 oxidase reacts on GA1, then it forms GA8. So if I write more clearly in the next page, So look here. So what happens? This GA20 forms what? GA1, or this GA20 forms GA29. Okay, so if GA2 oxidase acts, it will form GA29, which is an inactive gibberellin. Now GA20, when GA3 oxidase will act on GA20, as I said, what GA3 will do? GA3 will add a hydroxylation group to carbon 3. GA2 will add a hydroxyl group to carbon 2. So when a hydroxyl group is added to carbon 2, inactive gibberellins are produced, and when a hydroxyl group is added to carbon 3, active gibberellins are produced. Now on GA1, when GA2 oxidase acts again, so GA2 oxidase is a kind of inhibitor enzyme which inactivates GA, so it will form GA8, which is again an inactive gibberellin. Okay, I hope I am clear. So see here. So depending on whether the GA are hydroxylated at carbon 13 or not, okay, they form 12 or 53. Okay. So the next step was, so first step what we discussed, if I write again, in plastid what happened? In plastid, it was the formation of entcorine. So GGPP formed what? Copalyl. And from copalyl what formed? Entcorine ring structure. Corinol. Okay. Then the second step was occurring in ER. Here what happens? That corine is now transported from plastid to ER. Okay, and here in the ER it is oxidized. So corine, end corine, is oxidized here, corinol, here it is oxidized to end corinol and to end corinoic acid. Okay, so where is the oxidation step occurring in GA biosynthesis? It is occurring in ER. Okay, corinoic acid is formed, which is associated with the plastid envelope. Now here the enzyme which is acting, which is corinoic oxidase, this enzyme is present in where? Plastid envelope. Okay, so they have to come out from the plastid to show the oxidation step, after which they enters. Okay, after which they enters into the ER. Now here, after which end corinoic acid in endoplasmic reticulum, what happens? GA12 is formed. Okay, now here what happens in the ER, end corinoic acid is oxidized to GA12. Now GA12 aldehyde is formed. Okay, which is then oxidized to GA12. Which is then oxidized to GA12. Okay, now this GA12 is the first gibberellin in the biosynthetic pathway of all plants. Okay, and this is a precursor of all other gibberellins. Now, the hydroxylation of carbon 13 of GA12 gives GA53. So that I said I'll discuss later, that I'm discussing now. So hydroxylation at carbon 13 will produce GA53. Okay, GA53 will also produce some gibberellin, and GA12 will also produce some gibberellin. Okay, now all the enzymes involved are monooxygenase that utilize cytochrome P450 in their reaction. Okay, so all the enzymes used here are monooxygenase, and these enzyme uses cytochrome P450 is used in these reaction. Okay, now inhibitors of this second stage are known as paclobutrazol. I write the name of the inhibitors with red. Paclobutrazol. Okay. And other inhibitors of cytochrome P450. So here cytochrome P450 is one of the component of this pathway in the ER. So the inhibitors of P450 will inhibit the second step of gibberellin biosynthesis. Okay. Next. Now coming to the third stage, which was happening in the cytosol. Now here what we see, that active gibberellins were produced. Okay, so in the cytosol, GA12 or GA53, each of which has 20 carbon atoms, it is converted to other gibberellins. Okay, it was converted to other gibberellins. Now all the subsequent steps in the pathway, they are carried out by a group of soluble dioxygenases. So here the enzymes involved are dioxygenases. And here the enzymes that were involved were monooxygenases. Now these monooxygenases are the enzymes which require P450 as one of the important component. In the third step, the enzyme required are dioxygenases. Okay, now these enzyme uses Fe2+ and ascorbate as the cofactor. Okay, and here in this step what happens? Here what we see, that GA12 and GA53 was there, which will form another kind of gibberellins. Okay. So what happens? So from GA12 what will happen? GA19 and GA20 will be formed. GA12 will form GA53 by hydroxylation at carbon 13. GA53 will form by GA20 oxidase. There will be several steps in between. There will be several steps, and it will form what? Ga19. So by oxidative elimination of carbon 20 in the form of CO2, every step CO2 will be eliminated. Okay, in every step CO2 will be eliminated, Ga20 will form, then Ga20 oxidase will form Ga19. Okay, now so this Ga19, as we discussed, now Ga12 will form the active Ga1, okay, and Ga19, as we discussed here, see, this Ga19 will form Ga20 and then Ga1, okay, and Ga12 will form Ga9. So this will form Ga9, which will again form Ga20. Okay, so this Ga20 will ultimately form Ga1. Okay, so clear, Ga12 will form Ga9, which will again form Ga20, and from Ga20, Ga1 will be produced. Clear? So Ga20 is then converted to Ga1 by hydroxylation at carbon 3, we discussed. Now finally, Ga1 is inactivated by its conversion to Ga8, we discussed. Okay, by Ga8 at carbon 2, because the enzyme was Ga2 oxidase. Okay, now this hydroxylation can also remove Ga20 from the biosynthetic pathway. So Ga20 can be converted to Ga29 in the inactive form. Active to inactive, I'm encircling the one in from the, I'm encircling the one which is the inactive one, and Ga1 can form the inactive Ga8. Okay, by the enzyme I told Ga2 oxidase, and here also Ga2 oxidase. Okay, now inhibitors of the third stage of gibberellin biosynthetic pathway, it interferes with the enzyme that utilize 2-oxoglutarate as co-substrates. Okay, so whichever enzymes uses, all the inhibitors in the third stage, it will interfere with the enzyme. It will interfere with those enzymes that uses 2-oxoglutarate as their co-substrate. So inhibitors of the third stage include prohexadione, okay, which is specially useful for Ga3 oxidase. Okay, and this prohexadione, it inhibits the Ga3 oxidase enzyme, which forms a bioactive gibberellin. So inhibitor here is prohexadione. Please learn the inhibitors. Okay, this prohexadione, what it will do, it will inhibit Ga3 oxidase. What is the role of Ga3 oxidase? This Ga3 oxidase forms the bioactive gibberellin, which is Ga1. Now, IPP used to make gibberellin, it can arise from different cellular compartments in different tissues. Okay, IPP can be produced from different cellular compartments. Okay, it can be produced from plastids. Okay, and it can be formed in cytosol. Okay, so IPP, which is used in gibberellin biosynthesis in non-green tissues, in non-green tissues where IPP is the precursor for gibberellin synthesis, It is synthesized in plastids. For non-green tissues, the IPPs are synthesized in plastids. Okay, and in plastids, they are synthesized from glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and pyruvate. So what I said, in the non-green tissues, IPP is synthesized in plastids from the precursor glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and pyruvate. And in the cytosol, say for example in pumpkin, okay, here what happens, IPP is synthesized in the cytoplasm, okay, in the cytoplasm from mevalonic acid. So we discussed from where the mevalonic acid comes from. Mevalonic acid is synthesized from acetyl CoA. So why am I elaborating this topic a little more? To just give you a little bit more idea about IPP, that this IPP is synthesized from either plastid or cytosol. Okay, just to say that IPP can be from plastid, it can be from cytosol also. Now, the enzymes of genes and genes of gibberellin biosynthetic pathway have been characterized. I have summarized the three enzymes which was used in gibberellin biosynthesis. So the first is GA20 oxidase. What it does, I already discussed. This GA20 oxidase helps in the formation of GA20 from GA53 to GA20. Okay, GA53, there are successive oxidation steps and lead to the formation of GA20. Okay, all of these are oxidation steps and these steps are catalyzed by GA20 oxidase. Clear? Now GA3 oxidase, it adds the hydroxyl group to the 3 carbon position, and when the hydroxyl group is added to the 3 carbon position, bioactive gibberellin is produced. So bioactive gibberellin is GA1. But when the hydroxyl group is added to GA carbon number 2, then inactive gibberellins are produced, for example GA8, GA29. Okay, the next topic, transport of gibberellin. Now gibberellin are produced both in the xylem as well as in phloem. Okay, so I discussed last day also, I'm repeating now also, that if any chemicals are synthesized in the root, okay, they will be transported via the xylem. But if any chemicals are synthesized in the shoot, they will be transported via the phloem. Okay, so gibberellins are synthesized via xylem. When they are synthesized in the root, they are transported via xylem. When they are synthesized in shoot, they are transported via phloem. Now, so they are translocated via both xylem and phloem, and the gibberellins that are synthesized in the shoot are transported via phloem. The ones which are synthesized in the root are transported via xylem through water and minerals. So gibberellins do not exhibit polarity. Okay, they does not show the polar transport like from top to bottom like the auxin, but they show both up and down, up both the movement from the